brother in law. He's said the weathermen down there talking about it might hit 100, and the humidity is not too far behind. When I told him what our humidity was, at that time I think it was maybe between 50 and 60, my sister-in-law said, "Oh, pity you." So, it's certainly good to see each other this morning. We're sorry to announce that the passing of Aaron Nagel. We certainly express to all of her friends and family our sympathy, and they're in our prayers. You might note that Gail is not here. Mike is experiencing what I experienced last week. I'm glad the bride of my youth is with me today. But anyway, we want to remember Gail in my prayers. Also, Dan Mack has a vacuum pump on his foot. You know, he's been having a lot of trouble with his feet. And, Mike got some, I think it may be good news that they did a CAT scan, couldn't find any kidney stone. So he's hiding it well. But on the other hand, he also has an infection in his foot. Has to watch that very close. Their son, Wayne, has a problem with his lungs and black mold. Dave's dad is doing better, and we're thankful for that. All the poison gone?
Sounds like it.
Oh, good. And I think he may not be here next week, is it? Do you want to go pick up?
Yeah, next week I'm going to Chicago to pick them all up.
His peace and quiet's going to be gone. Pick up with Tammy and Nathan. But anyway. With that, let's go to our Heavenly Father in prayer. Our Father, we are so very thankful for the love that you have for us. As we recognize, Father, that we have sinned in your sight and have greatly offended you, we are so very thankful. And that seems to be such an understatement. But we are indeed thankful for our Lord and Savior, who was willing to suffer in such great anguish that we might be saved. Father, help us to understand more of what all was involved with his suffering, and to keep in mind that his suffering was caused by us. Even though it's been more than 2,000 years that he was crucified, yet, Father, we have sinned. And he died for us, that we might be cleansed of our sin, and that we might have the precious hope that when this life is over, we have a home with you and with him. We're also thankful that in your word you tell us that you do care for us, and that you're desirous of our casting our anxieties and cares upon you. For these that I've mentioned this morning, Father, we pray that you would be with them. With Aaron's family, Father, we pray that that you would give them comfort and strength with all the friends that knew her and that cared so very much for her. We pray that you would be with them also. Death brings such great sorrow. And we pray, Father, that you would be with all of those who knew her and loved her. We ask your blessings on Gail this morning, as she is not able to be with us. We pray for Mike also with his health problems. We'd ask you to be with Dan and pray for Mike and Stan and for all others, Father. And Father, we also want to thank you for hearing our prayers and answering. You are such a gracious and merciful God that we very humbly bow before you to offer unto you our love and our praise. As we come before you this morning in worship, may each of us recognize that we are before you. We are offering you our love. Help us to recognize more fully how holy you are and how great, how gracious and merciful. Bless us and use us in your name's honor and glory. In the name of Jesus.
Number 742.
such an honor and a privilege to be able to meet here and worship our God on the first day of the week. To gather around this Lord's table, as inscribed on the front of this table, it says, "This do in remembrance of me." Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ sacrificed himself on the cross for each and every one of us here today to provide a pathway to salvation for us because of our sins. He suffered horribly, and as the scriptures tell us, no greater love has any man than to lay down his life for our sins. Jesus Christ is our friend, our Savior. He laid down his life for each and every one of us. We have the example of that in Acts 20 and verse 7, where the disciples gathered together upon the first day of the week to pray and worship for God. As we partake of this unleavened bread, which represents Christ's broken and abused body on the cross, and following that, we will, of course, partake of the fruit of the vine, which represents his shed blood upon that. Let's partake of these emblems in a very serious manner, in a pleasing manner to God Almighty. And as we partake of this unleavened bread, we'll ask Mike to give thanks for it.
Let's pray. Dear Father, we ask that you be with us this morning as we partake of this bread, that we will be mindful that it represents your Son's body, as it was given on Calvary. Be with each one of us, we can do so in a manner pleasing on you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's go to our Holy Father in prayer, giving thanks for this evening. Holy Father in heaven, again we approach your humble throne with this so privileged to be able to be the Holy Father. Thank you, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, for your sacrifice upon the cross, shedding his blood on the cross for each and every one of us. As we partake of this fruit of the vine, representing that blood, let us do it in a pleasing manner to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. other commandment that they buy in store upon the first day of the week is food and prosper. We've all been so richly blessed, both materially and spiritually. So now it's time to consider giving back a portion of that material blessing that we have received back to the Lord so that the good work here can continue. And last night, thank you for blessing.
That's great. Dear Father, we thank you so much for the blessings you give us. We know that we are richly blessed in all the things that you bring to us. We ask now that you be with us as we prepare to give back. We might be cheerful givers. We might give to help others to continue to work in this area and to support those things that are necessary to spread your word. Bless us now, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. some years ago. They didn't have very many people there, and they were all sitting in the back three or four pews. And so I grabbed a rickety little music sheet stand, and I walked all the way up to the first ones, and their eyes were like, "What's he doing?" But standing up on the platform where the pulpit was, I looked out there, and I was like, "I'm all by myself in a desert land up here." So I went down there and got up close and personal, and maybe if I'm closer to the people, it'll keep me from wandering, as I tend to do in Alpena, because we don't use a microphone, so I'm able to just walk all over the place if I want to, and I just scream at the people. No, I'm just kidding. It's got very good acoustics in that building, and so we really don't have a need of a microphone until we have a need for one. But I want to welcome everybody this morning, and I thank you for the opportunity to be here with you. Bill and I were talking about that we do this every 3 months. In January, Scott and I just kind of canceled it for reasons that we both had for canceling it. And then, of course, April found us all not worshiping together in a building due to COVID-19. And so it seems like forever since I've been able to speak to you folks, with you folks, and to be able to worship with you. And I am glad that things are returning back to some semblance of normalcy. I should greet everyone who has joined us via some other way than in person, and we're thankful for anyone who has tuned in. And on that note, when the governor gave her order to stay home and stay safe, the Alpena congregation did not stream their services. We did not have anything going on Facebook. We didn't Zoom or any of those kind of things. Instead, we had for 40 days straight a daily message that went out to the members of the church, some members of our family, and friends as well. And so what I thought I would do today is bring 7 of those devotionals to you. And the scripture we're going to be in is the Psalm 23. And we're going to look at the first day was happened to be on a Sunday that we did a little overview of Psalm 23, and then every day we did one of the individual verses until we got through. And I thought I would bring that to you today, because we are yet in the midst of this COVID-19 pandemic and the crisis, as they call it, and other things, and hopefully some of the encouragement that we try to give to our membership in Alpena, you will be able to take from this psalm as well. So let's begin this morning by reading the whole of Psalm 23, and then we'll look at each verse in turn. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff. They comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. This psalm is a funeral favorite, but it is not a psalm that's directed to the loved one who has entered eternity's outer gate. Rather, it is addressed to those who remain to carry on, those who yet have days of hardship ahead of them. This psalm speaks of want or lack. It speaks of loss, thus the need of speaking also of restoration. It speaks of the valley of the shadow of death and even of enemies. Certainly, David, the psalmist here, does not paint life as a portrait of ease, of sunny rays, moonbeams, or butterflies and roses, those kind of things. He freely admits that life is a life that is full of hardships. It has its challenges and as well its sorrows. But let us not miss the central figure of this precious psalm, as well as those promises that are found in this portrait of life. The central figure, of course, is the shepherd, who is the Lord. The promises are the care and the concern, the calm, the providence and peace, the strength and satisfaction that comes in the shepherd to those who would be his sheep. Additionally, we find his perfect presence, grand guidance, and prevailing power given to those who with utmost confidence willingly and obediently follow him, the shepherd. The lyrics of one song says of the Lord, of the shepherd, of, in reality, Christ, sometimes he calms the storm, other times he calms his child. If we must endure the storm that is the COVID-19 pandemic, and I will reference this, even though I think that the things that are said really deal with every trial of life. If we must endure the storm that is the COVID-19 pandemic, may we also experience the calm of the shepherd's tender, gentle, and loving touch, as portrayed in the 23rd Psalm. Let us consider together each verse of this psalm, not really for an in-depth examination of the psalm or an investigation into it in each verse in depth, but for the purpose of prompting us to ponder the eternal benefits of following the great shepherd through lack and loss, in the valley, and even among those enemies. And so we turn to Psalm 23 and verse 1, and I like to begin every one of these verses with the phrase, "The Lord is my shepherd." Psalm 23:1 does it. But I like to begin every one of them with this, because truly, every one of the statements that we see in verses 2 through 5 come from the starting point of "The Lord is my shepherd." Psalm 23, verse 1 says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." The Lord, as we've said, is the central figure and the very object of this psalm. The Lord is Jehovah, the eternal, self-existing, living, almighty one. Not just the I Am, but the great I Am. Yet David identifies all-powerful God in the gentlest of terms, calling him a shepherd. A shepherd is one who leads and feeds. He provides and guides. He protects and corrects as well. "Since the Lord is my shepherd," David says, "I shall not want." That is, I shall never be completely devoid of that which I most need. The shepherd may withhold that which the sheep desires, as many of us have experienced in our life. We've desired things that necessarily were not good for us. And the shepherd might withhold those things that we desire but are ultimately destructive. But never will the shepherd withhold that which is needed, beneficial, and nourishing. Always in the right time, in the right measure, the shepherd supplies that which is needed. David had learned to be content with and accepting of whatever the Lord chose to provide, and we should be also. Thus David said in a very personal way, "The Lord is my shepherd." David begins with the object, the Lord, and then explains why he so trusts him. For us, these are difficult, strange, uncertain, and challenging times, aren't they? But really, what makes this pandemic any different than nearly every day, or at least every year of our life? We face challenging, uncertain, and strange, and difficult times. And David himself was no stranger to such times, and was yet able to write this most beautiful song of confident hope and trust. Why not try this? Reading this song, not now, but later on when you get home, if you've never done this before, try this. Reading the song with your name in place of the pronouns. It would go something like this. "The Lord is Jim's shepherd. Jim shall not want. He makes Jim to lie down in green pastures. He leads Jim beside the still waters," and so on and so forth. Better yet, try writing it down with your name in those places. It will make it very personal to you as well, And as David did, maybe you too can possess the same confident hope and trust that he did. And so we move to Psalm 23 and verse 2. The Lord is my shepherd. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. The language of this verse easily conjures up in our imaginations a scene of contented sheep grazing or lying upon lush, tender, green grass alongside a gently flowing, babbling brook. It is a scene of absolute tranquility, much like the immediate area that I picture, at least, that must have been around Jesus as he came walking upon the tumultuous waters in Matthew chapter 14. You recall that account. The disciples were in the ship, and Jesus comes walking upon the water to them, and there's a storm, and it must have been very calm right around Jesus himself. If we were able to zoom out, as it were, let's back up from this tranquil scene, and we would be able to then see farther out away from the scene. We would be expanding our view to include that which is going on all around this tranquil scene that's painted by David here. We may well see wind, rain, lightning, fire, maybe even hail. We might see devastating floodwaters or earthquakes, hurricanes or tornadoes. Our eyes may see entire schools of fish floating upon putrid, toxic pools like our own Great Lake Erie once was. It was so polluted that it even caught fire at one time. Birds may be dropping from tree and sky like victims of some unseen predator. Naturally, we would rather turn our faces away from the ugliness, wouldn't we? And we would focus once again upon the peaceful pasture, and we see why the sheep are so contented, confident, and secure. There, we see the shepherd. He's the reason. One moment, walking among the sheep, a touch here, a word there, then walking around the flock, looking for any signs of danger, but always, always, the shepherd is near. Jesus said in Mark 4, verse 39, "Peace, be still." It was directed as much to the hearts of the disciples as it was to the winds and the waves that Jesus was calming. The psalmist records the words of the Lord in Psalm 46 and verse 10, "Be still and know that I am God." If the Lord is truly your shepherd, be assured his powerful presence is also your peace. Psalm 23 and verse 3. The Lord is my shepherd. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. This verse refers to sheep already in the fold of the shepherd. The very same sheep that we previously seen in the peaceful providential repose in those green pastures beside the still waters. It is here that restoration occurs. In arriving at the green pastures beside still waters, the shepherd has led his sheep through many dangers. The sheep may be weary. They may be worn. The shepherd revives their spirit, renews their strength, readying them to move on. For to be led in paths of righteousness speaks of movement. The sheep, once restored, must arise and follow the shepherd to yet greener pastures, to waters more still, and to greater heights. We can never be satisfied as the sheep of the great shepherd to reach a plateau of spirituality and remain there, complacent and thus stagnant, thus putrefying in the very place to which we have been led for the purpose of restoring our souls and being led further onward to more perfect righteousness. For the glory of the shepherd, for his name's sake. I'm going to do something now that is referred to by rabbis of ancient times, and Jesus did this as well. They called it stringing pearls. And what they would do is they would take several passages of Scripture from the Old Testament and they would string them together into a single thought. And I'm going to do much the same, and when Jesus does it, it's really beautiful. You tell me how it comes out with this one. Jesus, the good shepherd, says of his sheep, "Blessed or approved of God are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled." Matthew 5:6. These sheep know their need of the shepherd, for it is not a man who walks to direct his own steps. Jeremiah 10 and verse 23. They are well aware that the mercies and compassions of God are new every morning. Lamentations 3:22-24. And that all things work together for the good of those who love, that is, obey God, to those who are the called, his sheep, according to his purpose. Romans 8 and verse 28. Consider to what new God-honoring height you will have risen after the shepherd has led you through the COVID crisis or whatever personal plight you may now be experiencing. Psalm 23 and verse 4. The Lord is my shepherd. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. The tendency of those who fear is to run, terror-stricken, in blind panic, doing oftentimes more harm to themselves and to others than the harm done by that which they fear. In today's verse, David paints a picture of such calm in the one whose shepherd is the Lord that they fearlessly walk in the very shadow of, the threat of, adversity, affliction, calamity, danger, and peril. The shadow cast by even death itself cannot shake the calm brought by the presence of the shepherd. The sheep, however, are not only calmed by the shepherd's presence, but find comfort in his rod and his staff as well. Now, the rod is not only a tool that the shepherd uses to defend the flock, something that he might discourage a predator of some sort from attacking his flock, but the rod is also an instrument of correction that is brought to bear upon the stiff-necked, rebellious sheep within the fold. There is comfort in correction, as well as the protection provided by that rod, for it is evidence of the shepherd's great love for his sheep. Hebrews 12 and verse 6 says, "Whom the Lord loves, he chastens." On the other hand, the staff is an instrument of gentle persuasion, drawing and guiding the distracted, often inattentive sheep who are in danger of wandering from under the shadow of death into that which casts the shadow. The rod and staff are symbolic of the word of God and the security found therein. In Psalm 119, a reverential monument to God's word, the psalmist expresses confidence in that security. Verse 81 says, "My soul faints for your salvation, but I hope in your word." In the face of these uncertain days, may we find in God's word strength and resolve, calm and comfort. Let us pray with the psalmist as he did in Psalm 119, verses 133 and 134. "Direct my steps by your word, and let no iniquity have dominion over me. Redeem me from the oppression of man, that I may keep your precepts." Psalm 23 and verse 5. "The Lord is my shepherd. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over." This verse would indicate that we are compassed about enemies. We are in the very midst of them, as though they are surrounding us on every side. And our enemies take many forms, don't they? They may be people, friend, foe, or even family. Our enemies may be illness and disease, poverty, and even wealth. Ideologies and theologies, traditions and opinions, pride and prejudices, and so many more. The end game of an enemy is to tear down and to destroy the object of its derision. In this case, that object is the sheepfold of the good and great shepherd. Yet yet in beautifully vivid images, the enemies of the sheep are portrayed as those who have been rendered powerless by the presence of the shepherd. The shepherd prepares a table, a feast of honor for his sheep before those who would dishonor them. The shepherd anoints the head of his sheep, sanctifying them and elevating them to a status equivalent to royalty within the sight of those who view them as nothing. The cup of the sheep runs over, intimating that the blessed protection, provision, care, and love of the shepherd is limitless, that it knows no bounds. The enemies of the sheep can only look on in wide-eyed wonder, bewildered and paralyzed by their own impotence against the sheep because of the shepherd. Psalm 40 puts an exclamation point upon this thought. And I just want to read, I guess, the last part of it. Psalm 40 and verse 13, beginning. Be pleased, O Lord, to deliver me. O Lord, make haste to help me. Let them be ashamed and brought to mutual confusion who seek to destroy my life. Let them be driven backward and brought to dishonor who wish me evil. Let them be confounded because of their shame who say to me, Aha, aha. Let all those who seek you rejoice and be glad in you. Let such as love your salvation say continually, The Lord be magnified, but I am poor and needy. Yet the Lord thinks upon me. You are my help and my deliverer. Do not delay, O my God. And may this as well be our plea and our purpose. O come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. Psalm 95, verses 6 through 7. Psalm 23 and verse 6. The Lord is my shepherd. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You know, we rarely, if ever, think of Psalm 23 as one of the prophetic psalms, but there seems to be a little hint of it here, for David closes the psalm speaking of both the physical and the eternal realms, the place where we exist now, the journey that we're on now, and the eternal place to which we're headed. We often perceive the phrase, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me, as referring to all of the previous blessings mentioned in this Psalm 23. And this has merit to think of them as such. But I think another viewpoint, maybe, of this psalm, this verse, also has merit. If the shepherd is leading, as verse 3 indicates, he is out in front as we, his sheep, follow him through this earthly land, from one blessed pasture to the next. And since the last statement of verse 5 was, my cup runs over, may I suggest that the goodness and mercy that follow the sheep is the abundant overflow left in the wake of the sheepfold. In other words, as the great shepherd blesses his sheep, they in turn bless others. They leave the place they have just vacated better off than when they arrived. Where the first half of this verse indicates movement, the second half of this verse speaks of a dwelling, a permanent fixture. In this life, we are certainly sojourning on a continuous journey through this temporal life, headed towards the eternal rest. Daniel 2:44 speaks of the church as the kingdom which shall never be destroyed. Jesus said the gates of Hades shall not prevail against that same kingdom that Daniel spoke of. If we are in Christ, we are in his sheepfold, which is the church, described in Colossians 1 and verse 13 as the kingdom of the Son of his love. Those who dwell in the sheepfold, the church, the kingdom, as we are here on this earth, will naturally dwell also in the eternal realm of God. For this kingdom in which we dwell, this sheepfold will be melded into the very presence of God Himself. There is a beautiful song entitled Better Is One Day. The chorus is based upon Psalm 84, verses 10 through 12, and it says this: Better is one day in your courts, better is one day in your house, than thousands elsewhere. I hope that in looking at each of these verses, as a means of seeing the great calm that even the shepherd David had in the Lord as his shepherd, that will be the calm that you can experience as well, no matter what you are going through. As Christians, that calm, assured confidence should be ours, shouldn't it? We shouldn't be afraid. What have we to fear? Even in death, we find ourselves better off. And for those of you who have no idea of the calm found in the shepherd because you've not yet obeyed the gospel, please, please let us know, because we can help you. We should all be able to say, the Lord is my shepherd, and then finish it with every statement found in Psalm 23. May that be your calm, assured confidence this day.
Open and offer to all freely. Be with us, Lord, as we depart from here, and